Hi, I'm Jake.
And I'm Christine.
A few days ago, we reacted to a Nostalgia Critic Christmas-themed episode. Now we're going to be reacting to a Cinema Snob Christmas episode from 2010. It's crazy to think these reviews are getting that old.
Yeah.
And recently, on my show, JMC Reviews, over on my main channel, I reviewed Silent Night, Deadly Night Part 2. So I thought, as a good tie-in, why don't we react to the Cinema Snob's review of Silent Night, Deadly Night Part 2. He reviewed the second one before the first one, just because the first one is a legitimately good Christmas-themed horror movie.
Mm-hmm.
Second one, it's entertaining. You gotta see it to believe it. Christmas. Ow.
Oh gosh.
Surely one of the more controversial horror films to come out of the 1980s was Silent Night, Deadly Night, a psychological slasher film about a man who dons a Santa suit and slays his way through naked chicks and sledders. The testing of this film got so ridiculous, you would have actually thought that the makers of this film physically molested the country's children. About the movie didn't even realize that it was only one of two Killer Santa films to be released around the same time. Where were these idiots when the movie Santa's Sleigh was released? In Silent Night, Deadly Night, and Christmas Evil, it was just a nut in a Santa suit. In Santa's Sleigh, Santa actually was killing people. So with all of that controversy, Silent Night, Deadly Night made a killing on home video, and naturally a sequel was warranted.
Controversy
Silent
brings
Night,
in
Deadly
the
Night
money.
Was released in 1987, which was...
Garbage Day! No!
Anyway, the movie was released...
Garbage Day!
Really? Whatever happened to patience in internet reviewing? Can't you at least wait
no
until
such
I
thing.
Get to that scene in the review?
Garbage Day! No!
That is a funny clue. Okay, fine. Silent Night, Deadly Night Part 2, like the first one, has become a legendary slasher flick. But for completely different reasons.
Yep.
With part one, it was the controversy. With part two, it's because of an internet meme that's the horror equivalent of It's a Trap. The scene itself has over 2 million hits on YouTube, and that's
eight
just
now.
For one video.
Wow.
Of
or
it.
Seven.
There are several
it's
videos of the same scene that are in the hundreds of thousands. Not only that, but the thing has been spoofed about as many times as the clip has been watched. With such classics as Laundry Day, April Fool's Day, or even Opposite Day. Seems like the only time it hasn't been spoofed is for, ironically, Christmas Day.
This kind of became its own little video for a while.
Mm-hmm.
Christmas Day!
Brad's buddy Jared.
Anyway, so let's talk about the movie that created the legend. I mentioned earlier how I'm only reviewing half of a movie, and that's true, because Silent Night, Deadly Night Part 2 is only half of a movie. The entire first half of this flick is told with flashback footage from the first film. I don't know what's worse, when the stock footage is all clumped together at once, or spread out through the entire movie, such as the Death Nurse films. The Death Nurse films showed scenes of criminally insane, not in context to anything, because Death Nurse wasn't a sequel to Criminally Insane. Whereas with the Silent Night, Deadly Night footage being clumped together in the first half, we are seeing a narrative in the stock footage. So it's almost like I'm watching two movies instead of half of a movie. God damn it. Christmas sucks.
Comes off as very lazy.
Played by a man named Eric Freeman, and his performance is one of the many things ridiculed about the movie. But most people have only seen that one clip, and it was a pretty unreadable line. So maybe in the rest of the movie, he's not too terribly bad.
What makes you think you can bullshit your way into my head? Like every other piece of shit!
The hell? This guy's delivery is about as subtle as the H-bomb. How does one act opposite that? There you go. Just try to match his overacting with your finger. That'll give dignity to the scene. Eric Freeman plays Ricky, the little brother of the killer from the first film. Part 2 opens up with Ricky in jail, and the title card reads December 24th. And you can tell because of the green leaves and birds chirping outside the window. Yeah,
maybe he's in Florida.
Yeah.
Or Cali.
US, but nice weather does not exist in Christmas movies. A psychiatrist comes in to get Ricky's backstory, meaning he retells every single event from the first movie. Even though the first movie began when Ricky was just a baby.
It was a long time ago. Could you possibly remember all that?
Yeah, that's a good question. How does he remember any of that?
Because I was there.
I can't argue with that. As we know from the first one, Ricky and his older brother Billy's parents were killed by a crazed maniac dressed up like Santa Claus. That is all we need to know from the first movie. But it keeps going.
You in a hurry, Doc? Am I wasting your valuable time?
Thanks, Eric. Christ, this guy would overact a fart. Ricky continues to tell the psychiatrist about Billy's experiences dealing with the sadistic nuns at the orphanage. You know, I'm quite impressed with Ricky's Peter Panning-like capabilities of remembering shit from when he was a baby, but it takes a whole new level of talent to remember events that you were not physically there for. From Billy getting beat by the nuns to Billy working in the toy store. The only way Ricky would remember
they were on opposite sides of a town
that went out. It was a movie, and Ricky wrote the script for it. Oh shit, we used up all the tape on the stock footage. Guess there's no more movie. I like how it even flashes back to incidental scenes, like the cops cruising around looking for Billy. It's great when you're a half hour into one movie while simultaneously being an hour into another movie.
I've been squashing like a bug.
Damn. That face.
Yes, my overacting is gonna get a hell of a lot worse. But back to the stock footage. Remember the scene of the non-killer Santa mistakenly getting gunned down by the cops in the first one? It's imperative that we're reminded of that for this movie. Interesting how a movie known for its terrible acting is continuing to remind us how much genuinely better acted the first movie was. Well, since this is the end of the last scene from Silent Night, Deadly Night, are they gonna show us that movie's ending credits as well? Might as well, they've shown everything else from it. Since we still don't know why Ricky is in jail, given how he was just a kid when the first movie ended, we have to see him tell us that story too. But at least he's flashing back to original footage this time.
But kindly Sister Mary was able to find me a family. The Rosenbergs. They definitely did not get involved with Christmas.
You know, with them celebrating Kwanzaa and all. Mm-hmm. Much like his brother in the previous movie, Ricky is constantly haunted by the demons of his past. Okay,
fucking
apparently
nuns.
He's afraid that nunsploitation movies are gonna come bore him to death. What's interesting here is how much better the younger actor playing Ricky is. See, he's not even saying a word, and he's better than Eric Freeman. Eric Freeman can't say three words without it looking like his face is gonna explode.
Cut it out. Here it comes.
Young Ricky gets his first taste of blood when he happens upon a date rape where he proceeds to repeatedly run over the guy with the Jeep.
Okay.
Thank you.
Back and forth. It's actually pretty funny.
Red car. It all makes sense, man.
Red rum.
Red car. Good point.
Well, now Freeman is just openly mocking the movie. Ricky continues to tell the doctor about his troubled past.
My old lady couldn't afford to send me to college.
Yeah, or acting school for that matter. Ricky turns vigilante yet again and straight up murders a mafioso trying to reclaim his money.
Umbrella to death.
Red umbrella. It's all starting to come together. But Ricky's anger starts to settle when he falls in love on the set of Lords of the Flatbush, apparently. I almost killed you. Ricky and his new girlfriend Jennifer hit it off rather well, despite some awkward moments.
That was my first time. I thought.
For a guy that grew up in an orphanage, he's pretty ripped.
What I'm trying to say is that her vagina chews dicks like I chew the scenery. Things are getting a little dark yet again when Ricky's thirst for blood continues in a movie theater. I can't imagine what the hell would set him off.
What did you say this movie was about?
Oh, it's great. It's about this guy dresses up like Santa Claus and kills people.
What?
I'm holding you up, asshole.
That's the first movie! Okay, now
yeah,
this
it
movie's
is
just fucking with me. Jennifer witnesses Ricky's true psychotic personality when she's confronted by her douchey blonde boyfriend in the street.
I don't think he's a natural blonde.
It's not doing anything for me. If I want to see a blonde John Cryer get killed, I'd prefer it be the real John Cryer.
Shit.
What are you doing?
What? No thank you this time?
No.
Punish.
Oh.
What was the really necessary? You're taking the seriousness out of a scene that just
sorry
showed a man electrocuted with jumper cables. After Ricky strangles Jennifer, this sets him off on one of the most hilarious murder sprees since that movie where the Zodiac killer bounced an old woman to death with her car hood. Is this guy? Looks like if little Ronnie Howard grew up to become Barney Fife.
You won't believe this.
It's coming. Let's give it a couple of seconds. It's coming. He's got precious time left to become a perfect shot with that gun.
Here it is.
Garbage day! No!
There's your money shot. Also, let's look at this scene again. Would you ever think, just from looking at this clip, that this is from a Christmas movie? Would you think that after looking at any scene from this movie? What? The title Silent Night, Deadly Night
Summer
Part 2
yeah
doesn't give away that there would be a scene of a man in sunny 60-degree weather shooting a man on the sidewalk in the middle of summer? But that's not all he does, no. This scene does not begin with Garbage Day, and it doesn't end there either.
Bingo!
He spends this entire sequence either cackling like an idiot or acting like a stone-faced killer.
Stop it!
Seriously, so who told them to act like this?
So
did they
bad.
Tell them to combine the traits of Snidely Whiplash and the Terminator? Bummer. Now that all the flashbacks from this movie and other movies are over with, Ricky leaves prison because he's killed the doctor.
With
and
the
as we
film,
all know,
the tape
psychiatrist is
the
only
recording.
Guard in most prisons. After stealing a Santa Claus suit, Ricky tracks down the Mother Superior, whose house number is 666. Now why the hell would it not live in that house? It's nice and all that someone is finally getting
she's
revenge
so close,
on the Mother Superior, because let's face it, she was the true villain of the first movie. We all wanted to see her die, but she didn't, and that sucked. Yet here, she finally gets her comeuppance, but she's played by a different actress. Somehow, it just doesn't feel the same, especially since we remember what she looked like, because the whole first act of this movie showed the original actress. It's like seeing a revenge movie where the villain is replaced in the final scene. It doesn't work, but at least they still make her a bitch.
I am not afraid of you.
Really? Not afraid? Let's back the movie up a couple of scenes. The shit in your pants disagrees with how not afraid you are.
The cat.
That's Lloyd. Or Chloe.
Okay, now she's just a fucking idiot. The cops show up to try to save Mother Superior, and oh no, it's too late. By the way, Nun Habit's notorious for holding in blood in case of decapitation. Ricky is shot a few times by the cops, but luckily he's saved by the fact that this is a slasher film. So let me guess, that's the most many of you have seen of the movie Silent Night, Deadly Night Part 2. It's amazing how the internet works. It can make stars out of unknown actors like Freeman and give notoriety to movies made 20 years in the past just by showing a single 10-second clip. All for a movie that wasn't even intended to come together as a whole movie. And seriously, it never really did anyway. Part 2's director was hired to recut the first film for a newer release and feature a couple of scenes of Eric Freeman telling the story as it went along, not unlike what Fred Olen Ray did with John Carradine in Demented Death Farm Massacre. Once the screenwriters wrote extra scenes with Freeman as Ricky, the movie suddenly became a sequel, even though the new footage only added up to about 45 minutes. So that's why the 40 minutes of stock footage was added to pad out this now sequel, when it was only intended to be a re-release of the first film. Even the casting of Freeman himself was suspect. It came down between him and an actor with experience, yet Freeman was chosen because of his rugged good looks.
I won't fault them on that.
Because, let's face it, without Freeman, this movie would have just faded off into obscurity, much like Silent Night, Deadly Night Part 3. Or Part 4. Part 5.
Toy move. Killer toys.
That has yet to actually be made.
No one has since has been made.
Down Freeman about this movie. Not even the DVD distributors when it came time to record an audio commentary. Honestly, I hope the guy resurfaces someday. He made a movie noteworthy because of a cheesy two-word line of dialogue. I think I now know what we all want for Christmas this year. It's for Eric Freeman to finally come out of retirement.
I don't sleep.
You should.
He is such a bad actor.
Such a bad actor.
But so entertaining. And he did resurface about 5 years ago. And he's kind of been writing the cult phenomenon of the second Silent Night, Deadly Night. And a few years ago, he did a video where he told people that they went to his eBay account, mm-hmm. they could buy posters for Silent Night, Deadly Night Part 2, and he would personally sign whatever they wanted.
Yeah.
Brad got a poster where I think he had something to say, had him say something along the lines of, "Eat shit, cinema snob."
That's funny.
And it's a pretty good review. Brad has an amazing, sarcastic, and charismatic personality.
Yeah.
And it's funny how he can come off as both suave while also being pretty profane.
Mm-hmm.
Like, have these two things that shouldn't really go together, but he makes them mix so well.
Yeah.
And he's a great writer in terms of comedy and dialogue.
Mm-hmm. Yeah, it's very good.
Think you'll ever check out Silent Night, Deadly Night Part 2?
Hell no. Sorry.
Maybe the first film.
Maybe, yes. That looked actually interesting. No, I can't stand bad acting. That guy was terrible.
He seemed like a nice guy in real life. He did a video with a friend of his,
mm-hmm.
where, because apparently Eric has written a screenplay that would be a direct sequel to the second movie.
Oh,
and in this video, he and his buddy, like his buddy apparently pretends he's been impersonating Eric, trying to sell the script. So to settle who's the real Eric, they look at each other and go, "Garbage day." And he's like, "Garbage day, garbage day, garbage day," back and forth.
So many different ones.
If you want to see more of the Cinema Snob, go to the YouTube channel, Stone Gremlin Productions, and check it out. Or go to his website, thecinemasnob.com, where you can find some stuff that is not directly available on YouTube. Brad is one of my all-time favorite inspirations, and some days, like, Brad Jones and Doug Walker together are my favorite content creators and inspirations. But on some days, depending on the mood I'm in, Brad takes the number one spot.
Mm-hmm.
And just because his taste in movies, like, I like Doug's style more,
mm-hmm.
but Brad's taste is closer to mine.
Yeah.
So I can...
Make it relatable.
Yeah, I connect a bit more.
Yeah.
And, great review. Hope you enjoyed our reaction to it, as much as we enjoyed watching it.
Keep giving the good content.
Happy holidays.